How are we doing, California? Sweet. All right. We will be sticking with a Wisconsin theme for our speakers with Emily Jashinsky. Emily is a commentary writer for the Washington Examiner. Prior to this, she was a spokeswoman for Young America's Foundation. She is a graduate of the George Washington University, where she studied political science and creative writing. During her time at GW, Emily served for 2 years as president of the school's YAF chapter. As the chapter's leader, Emily pushed GWYF to hold a variety of activism events, including a GPA redistribution video and the Cemetery of the Innocents, which were covered by the national media as well. Emily successfully expanded GWYF's size and influence on campus by increasing membership, earning more funding from the university, and utilizing the power of new media. Emily is a native of southeastern Wisconsin, and she was introduced to Young America's Foundation after tuning in to a live stream of the National Conservative Student Conference. Seniors, that's all you guys. Sign up for it. Upon arriving at GW in 2011, Emily quickly joined the university's YAF chapter and remained involved until her graduation in 2015. Her writing has been published by major think tanks and conservative media outlets. Emily has also worked as a researcher at AEI, where she served under Christina Hoff Summers' intern for 2 years. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Emily Jashinsky.
All right. Thank you, Connor. Thank you so much. Hello, everyone, and thank you all for being here. As Connor mentioned, my name is Emily Jashinsky. I'm the director of the National Journalism Center at Young America's Foundation. So what we do, in case any of you are interested in journalism, is train college students to become good journalists. We say truth-seeking journalists because there are so many journalists who don't seek truth anymore. So that's what we do as part of YAF. So when you're in college, if you're interested, let us know. We'd love to help you. But on that note, we're going to start with a little exercise. Don't worry, it's not a quiz, so you can tune out the rest of my speech. Don't worry about that. But if you have a notebook and a pen in front of you, this is gonna sound really weird, so bear with me. Please write down 2 to 3 sentences accurately describing that chandelier. 2 to 3 sentences accurately describing that chandelier. Told you it was gonna sound weird. I told you. Give you like 30 seconds. A little bit more time. All right, so we'll come back to those descriptions shortly. Again, not a quiz or anything, but I will ask for a couple volunteers as we start wrapping up here. But let's first start with the story of Betty White. Do you guys know who Betty White was? Just nod your head, okay. You don't have to like scream, be like, I'm the biggest Betty White fan in the world, but nod your head, okay. Betty White, so she was on Golden Girls, maybe some of your parents liked that show, but she also became sort of like a pop culture icon for millennials, for Gen Z, as she got older and older. But Betty White was born in 1922 when Warren G. Harding was the president of the United States. Warren G. Harding was born in the last year of the Civil War. So when Betty White passed away, she had 2 million followers on something called Instagram. That's from a woman who was born the year that Warren G. Harding was president, and Warren G. Harding himself was born the last year of the Civil War. What does this have to do with media? We'll get to that in just a second. Bear with me. According to PBS, Betty White was also the very first woman to appear on a brand new technology that we call television. A woman who died with millions of followers on Instagram was the first woman to appear on television. It was an experimental broadcast. So before TV debuted at the World's Fair in 1939, shortly after Betty White had turned 17 years old, she appeared on this experimental broadcast from RCA. TV was not commercially available when Betty White got in the game. It was literally an experiment. And that woman died in the era of TikTok. Think about that. These are huge, sweeping, dramatic changes to the way that humans interact with each other. And these are new avenues for the way that we share information. Think about that. You know, so we think of social media as a sort of social thing, right? It's in the name. But it's also completely changed the way that we understand the world, and it's changed the way we consume news. And the way we consume news is the way we understand the world. So while Betty White and TikTok and experimental TV in 1939 sounds like it has nothing to do with the news that we consume now, it actually has everything to do with the news that we consume now. This woman was on an experimental broadcast in black and white. In black and white. Some of your grandparents probably can tell you when the switch happened from black and white to color TV. I can tell you about when the switch happened to videos on social media, which weren't always a thing. And that sounds really dumb compared to black and white versus color TV. But really, these changes are huge. We just sort of take them for granted now. But Betty White died a couple years ago. So if you think about the year 2107, that's 83 years from now. If you're 17 today, so that's the age Betty White was when she was on an experimental TV broadcast, think about how the news will be delivered when you're 99 years old. That's how old Betty White was when she passed away. What will you have lived through technologically, and what world will your children and your grandchildren inherit? It's kind of a wild thought, because the world that Betty White lived through, the news was being delivered over radio, right? And radio was just starting to change the way people understood war. Imagine if, when there are hot conflicts in places like Europe or the Middle East, all we had was radio to understand them. Imagine actually all we had was writing to understand them. And you could go back even further to a time when nobody even knew what was happening in different parts of the world. Think about that. Again, it sounds like it's about technology. It sounds like it's about really old technology. But this stuff is really new, and it has completely upended the way the world interacts with itself and the way that we consume news in some really specific ways. So when we think about the news, it's really important to focus on the kind of basic fundamentals of journalism, because that doesn't change. At least the goal should be that doesn't change as the mediums change. Of course it has. But when I grew up, for example, the news was not on the internet yet. Wasn't on the internet. And I'm only 30. So think of how many people are alive before the news was on the internet. Voters, your parents, your grandparents. Just keep that in mind. When you were younger, Twitter was new. YouTube was new. TikTok did not exist. We could have a whole conversation about TikTok. Maybe we will. But it didn't exist. And now it is where so many people spend the majority of their time. It's where people get, people your age get tons of their news, if not most of their news, if not all of their news. It didn't even exist. And you guys are in high school. These are really big changes, and statistically, these are really major sources of news right now that were not on the map in our own lifetimes. So let's talk about what the news is and what the news isn't. Journalism, this is a little handy definition I use, is the practice of either conveying or analyzing facts that are in the public's interest. It's the practice of either conveying or analyzing facts that are in the public's interest. So you can do it by writing, you can do it by speaking, or with pictures, or with video. But because journalism deals first and foremost in facts, this is gonna sound groundbreaking. Journalists must first accept that facts exist. Can we all agree that facts exist? Facts exist, right? Now, you go tell a newsroom in Washington that and see what response you get, because we don't all agree that facts exist, that truth is not relative anymore. Think about that. It would be controversial to go into a news, to go into the New York Times right now and say, facts exist. And then sort of talk about some facts that we can all agree on. Because truth is relative, right? To the perspective of so many people who have gone through our terrible education system and have learned about the world through our popular culture, we cannot even agree on that sort of basic thing that you have to agree on to do journalism. If truth is relative, journalism can't exist, period. And that's where a lot of the confusion, I think, comes in now. Because if news is about gathering new information, that's what journalists are tasked with, gathering it and then conveying it, kind of the two-step process. So it's not just writing, I'm out in Santa Barbara today, the weather is really nice. It would be, you know, getting the research on what the temperature is, for example, and then conveying that to an audience. It's not just being like, oh, hey, it's sunny, right? That's not doing the news as a meteorologist. You would be sort of curating information and then conveying it. So these are two things that you absolutely have to have facts to be able to do. It's one thing to be there when something happens. So if something in the public interest happened right here, we would all be in great position to cover it, as we say in the news business, because we were here. We know that it happened. But it's another thing, and this is crucial, to be able to write or to be able to speak about what we saw here accurately. So let me pick on Connor for a second. Let's say Connor comes up here to introduce a speaker, trips and falls on his face. We're all laughing and applauding, because that sounds hilarious, right? Yeah. Yeah! I'm so sorry, Connor. But maybe one of us did not find that very funny, and maybe that person is Connor. Connor might write about what happened very differently than the rest of us would write about what happened, right? Because our perspectives and our experiences matter in what we choose to convey about the information we gathered. You see how that works? So think about this. If I see a red truck outside this building, I could say, quote, there is a red truck outside the building. I could also say, there is a large red truck outside the building. Or I could say, there's a new expensive Ford F-150 parallel parked against a curb in Santa Barbara. Or I could say there's a polluting gas guzzler taking up space on the street in beautiful, environmentally conscious Santa Barbara. Am I describing the exact same thing? Right? Dramatically different descriptions of the exact same thing. That happens every single day with everything you're consuming in the news. There is absolutely no perfect way to describe a red truck outside the building. There are ways that are more neutral, quote unquote neutral, than others to describe that red truck outside the building, but there is no way that is the most neutral, right? There is no quantitative metric of what is the most neutral description of a red truck on the street. It's impossible. What we can do is aspire to describe it as neutrally as possible. We can try to do that, but there is no benchmark for what quote unquote neutral actually is. So keep that in mind as we go forward. But you're also picking and choosing what to describe that's outside. So it's not just the words. It's not just the words that you're using, you know, whether it's, the truck is obviously gonna be red. Let's say it's red. You could call it, you know, bright red, you could call it dark red, but you also are choosing to describe it as a truck, right? You could call it just an automobile. You could choose to describe what the interior looks like or not. You're choosing what facts are in the public's interest. So what I'm explaining right now is all the different ways that bias creeps into news coverage in ways that you don't even think about. So what I just described is called selection bias, choosing what to talk about. That's a huge, huge way that journalists create biased environments in the news, just choosing what to talk about. You know, a lot of journalists, if they live in New York City, or even in Washington, D.C., where I live, they take subways, or they take bikes. They don't drive because they don't live in the suburbs or in rural areas like most of the rest of the country. So they're going to choose to tell fewer stories about gas prices. You see how that makes sense? Because they're not thinking about the price of gas every single day. If the cost of gas goes up, they might not even notice it because they don't ever buy gas. They don't have a car. They don't worry about it. So they're just naturally going to choose to tell fewer stories about things that don't affect their lives. Again, they can try. They can try to do that differently. But it's still going to require effort. It's not going to come totally naturally to them. Does that make sense? Selection bias. Another thing would be framing. So we just talked about how I could describe the truck as a gas guzzler or like a beautiful new practical F-150. That's called framing bias. So I can frame this as a good thing or I can frame this as a bad thing. And that's probably the biggest form of bias, just deciding how to color any given fact that you're talking about. So if you're talking about, I don't know, something non-controversial like Donald Trump, you can choose to use really charged, partisan, angry language. You can choose to use really supportive, loving language. Some of the language he uses about himself, for example, when he's like, your favorite president, that's how he describes himself. But you know, the news media doesn't tend to describe him that way. But this is just called framing. That's just the language that you're choosing. And so those are two things that as you read the news, I really, really hope you can start paying attention to because it kind of helps you decode the story that's being told in subtle ways that we don't, again, we don't even think about them unless we pause and try to analyze it. It just sort of becomes the air that we breathe. And a really good example of that is the idea that Donald Trump had colluded with Vladimir Putin to win the presidential election in 2016. For a lot of the country, that just became the air that we breathed. It was taken as a given. This was an established fact that Donald Trump was an asset, an agent of the Russian government. That was repeated so many times across the news media for years that if you polled today, a large swath of the country still believes it. Still believes it. It just sort of became the air we breathe because so many networks, this is called selection bias again, were choosing to talk about it every single day. Like it was the most important story in the world. One of my favorite examples that we use with the NJC students, this one's so good. How many of you are from the Midwest or like the South, areas where you get a lot of tornadoes? Okay, cool, cool. All right, so not cool that there are tornadoes, but cool that you're from the Midwest. There's a tweet from a liberal journalist. This is just so beautiful. I couldn't have written it. I couldn't have scripted it better. In the middle of this Russia collusion hysteria, I think it was like 2017, and he took a screenshot from CNN, MSNBC, and some other networks, and then a screenshot of Fox News. And it was what each cable network was talking about at the given moment. And he just tweeted, NBC, Trump, Russia. CNN, Trump, Russia. Fox News, how about that weather we're having? And the screenshot from Fox was a reporter in Oklahoma reporting on this devastating storm that was about to plow through people's houses, was going to cost lives, did in fact cost lives and millions of dollars. And it's just, again, a great example of how if you live in New York or DC, as I think this reporter does, all you think about is Trump, Russia. It must be the most important story. All the networks must be talking about it every single day. But a tornado, that's just weather, right? Like, that's just weather. Why is Fox News concerned about weather? Well, maybe because it matters a whole lot to people that are going to be affected by the storm, or people who love people who are going to be affected by the storm and might be worried about it. That is one of my favorite examples of selection bias, because it is just the perfect beltway. That's what we call the DC area bias. That, like, why would you not be talking about Trump and Russia, which turned out to be largely debunked? Why would you be talking about this tornado? Keep those things in mind when you just are looking at what the news is choosing to bias in and of itself. Again, you can try your best to be as, quote, neutral as possible, but it's still an aspiration. There's no perfect way to do it, but if you're dealing with facts, you have to do your very best to actually deal with facts. If you say you're dealing with facts and opinions, that's fine. You still have to do your best, but at least you're being dishonest. It's when you're being honest. It's when you're being dishonest that we have a really big problem. So I'm an opinion journalist. I work somewhere called The Federalist, and that's openly a conservative news website. When I write a piece for The Federalist, I'm not pretending to be the literal voice of God describing what happened when Connor tripped and fell on his face, right? I'm not pretending to be that. Let's say I'm pretending to be, you know, really pro-Connor. Like, I'm not pretending, I am. Let's say I'm openly very pro-Connor in this situation. So I'm gonna describe it, and I'm gonna say, you know, it was really sad when Connor tripped and the whole room laughed at him. And that's not dishonest, because it's my perspective and I'm openly telling you where I'm coming from. The problem would be if I pretended I was both, I was doing a neutral pro-Connor and anti-Connor description and gave you one that wasn't neutral. Do you see what I mean by that? If you say you're coming from this position of abject neutrality, total neutrality, and then you don't actually give neutral descriptions, that's where the media is right now. So there's a really good example from CNN. They ran an advertising campaign. This was back in like 2017, 2018, and they had an apple on the screen, and the script was, the narrator said, "This is an apple. Some people might try to tell you it's a banana, but this is an apple." You get where they're going with that? That, you know, we CNN, we're telling you it as it is. Other networks are trying to tell you that an apple is a banana, but not us, not us at CNN. Meanwhile, one of their top anchors, who did claim to be neutral, Chris Cuomo, was saying, "Listen, I just call it as I see it. The pro-life side is more about feelings. The pro-choice side is more about science." That is not neutral. That is not anywhere near neutral. So when CNN is running this ad campaign, they're openly proving that they are basically the worst at doing this in a million different ways. I mean, you could talk about Trump, Russia, another really good example. Do any of you remember the anecdote about Covington Catholic? I'll tell you what, CNN remembers this because CNN got sued and had to settle for millions of dollars over this. What happened with Covington Catholic, I saw some heads nodding, but if you don't remember, there was a boy who was with his school out at the March for Life. He had traveled to DC for the March for Life, and he was wearing a Make America Great Again hat. And he was on the National Mall with his friends when he was approached by Native American activists, and one particular Native American activist that started to aggressively walk up to him. And this was caught on picture, it was caught on video, and this young boy had kind of a smile on his face, and the media saw that, and without doing any due diligence, and again, this is why CNN got sued and had to settle, same thing with the Washington Post, they were so convinced just by this picture that they ran stories about how he had antagonized the activist. He was a young white boy, so they ran with that, saying this young white Trump supporter was antagonizing Native American activists. Now, quickly, within like a couple of hours, the full video came out and showed that it was the other way around. But the media had seen a picture that confirmed its priors, what it thought was happening, and did not even pause to look for the full video or literally zoom out from the picture, right, to figure out what actually happened. And when you don't do that, you are doing the, this is an apple, I'm telling you it's a banana. They're doing the opposite. They're doing exactly what they pretend they're not doing. Instead of just saying, "Hey, I work at the Washington Post, I'm a reporter, I'm super liberal. So when I tell you that I think this young white Trump supporter was antagonizing Native Americans, you can say, all right, well, maybe that's just your opinion." But no, they claim to, again, be channeling the voice of God and be the sort of arbiters, being the arbiters of what is neutral. So media trust is really low right now. Have you guys seen any of the polls on that? It's really low. It's actually at an all-time low. It dipped again just recently back to an all-time low, which is crazy because media, journalists who, you know, missed what was happening in 2016 when the host of Celebrity Apprentice beat the former Secretary of State in a presidential election. Journalists looked around and said, "How did we get this wrong? How did we miss this? We're going to do better in the future." They've all like sprinted in the opposite direction and like are aggressively doing much, much worse. But that's where, you know, you look at, we're almost 10 years after that glaring mistake when they all said there was a 99% chance of Hillary Clinton winning the presidential election, and they're getting worse. Media trust is actually as low as it was now after the presidential election of 2016. So that's completely the opposite direction. And what's the good news in that is media trust really deserves to be low. Like, it's really good that the trust in media is low. I would be terrified if everyone trusted the media right now. Like, that would be really frightening. But it's a big problem that we don't have a system where people trust the news. There's a reason that we have a First Amendment. We need to have a free press in order to function as a constitutional republic. The founders understood that. It's really important. There are prior eras in American history, and maybe some of you have learned about it, when the press was very, very partisan. It's before, you know, radio came along and TV came along and you had broadcast licenses. So, you know, you had ABC, CBS, NBC competing to get the most advertisers. And to do that, you have to get the most people watching your show. It's not like that anymore, because everything has splintered back to what it used to be. And when the founders were writing the Constitution and our system, news came through partisan pamphlets. So everyone actually knew the slant. That went away in the 20th century, around the time that Betty White was experimenting with TV, just because the technology required broadcast licenses and all of that. But we're going back to that era. The problem is that nobody's ready to be honest about whether they're a partisan when they're delivering the news. And that's a really scary place to be. If you think about a window, Maybe you're at a zoo and you're looking at a parrot through a window. If the window is clear, you can make your own judgment about what you're seeing, right? You're seeing the parrot, and so you can internalize your description of the parrot. You can say, "I'm pretty confident what's happening on the other side of this glass." If the window is cracked up and all smudged, it's gonna be way harder for you to see the parrot. And if you're on different sides, let's say you're over here, your mom's looking at the parrot, she's over here, the light is going to be filtered through those cracks and those smudges differently. So you're gonna be seeing something that might be completely different just depending on what side of the window that you're standing on. Now, this hypothetical, again, is a little weird, but let's say you have to make a decision based on what that parrot looks like. You have to make a decision on it. Maybe you wanna buy the parrot and you have to make a decision based on what that parrot looks like. Would you rather be looking through the clear window or the cracked and smudged window? Right now, our news media is a totally cracked and smudged window. It's not clear, and a lot of that is because of the biases that we discussed, but it also is because they aren't doing a very good job because of those biases. It makes it really hard for them, and they're just not being honest about the biases. The press is our window into public affairs. Why is the window smudged? I mean, fundamentally, it's because people who claim to be these clean windows are more like funhouse mirrors. And they're lying. They're being dishonest. Why is that? I mean, some people just do not believe in absolute truth anymore. They believe in my truth and your truth. You've probably heard this from some of your peers. Well, my truth is this. Rebecca's truth is that. It's not the way to go about life, but it's definitely not the way to go about journalism. And you know, if you believe that your opinion is actually a fact, you can't have disagreement because someone who disagrees with you is anti-fact. If you guys are talking about politics with your friends, you're talking about something with your friends, how many times does it come up? Like, you just don't. Yeah, I can't talk to somebody who doesn't even have the facts, right? And it's true. You know, a lot of us, it's kind of hard to actually get facts completely now, because even for me, I work in journalism. It's hard for me to know what's true and what's false. You have to put a lot of work into it. But you can't even have conversations if we can't agree on some very, very basic facts anymore. And that's one of the biggest problems. So You know, people who work in journalism generally went to the same schools, they make about the same amount of money, they live in the same regions of the country. They have the same approach to religion, they watch the same movies, they go to the same stores. They live clustered around what's called super zips. So those are some of the wealthiest zip codes in the country, you know, out by Los Angeles, San Francisco, but especially New York City and Washington, D.C. That's a very, very different thing. Literally, that means you watch different TV shows now. It wasn't always like that in this country, but that's changed. There's some really good social science. If you're interested, I would encourage you to read a book called Coming Apart. But that just means that people who live and are clustered in certain areas have the same type of education. They just tend to vote the same way. They don't go to church on Sundays. They have all kinds of different rates. Their lifestyles are just different. They tend to all be pro-choice. Pro-choice, quote-unquote pro-choice, pro-abortion. They tend to, not go to church on Sundays. They tend to not own guns. Many of them don't own cars or drive regularly. So that just changes the way that you live and you see the world. And if you don't recognize that, if you think your life is, you know, totally representative of the average American's life, you're not doing a good job, and you should probably drop this idea that you are channeling the voice of God. It's okay to be an opinion journalist. I'm an opinion journalist. It's okay to do that. What's not okay is to be somebody who is super opinionated and has no ability to neutralize those opinions. Sometimes journalists lie on purpose, but sometimes they lie because they don't even recognize how debatable their so-called facts are, things that they think are facts, because they don't live with people who disagree with them, they don't talk to people who disagree with them, they don't worship with people who disagree with them, so they don't understand them, they don't know those types of people. And, you know, like the lab leak, the COVID lab leak, another really great example of this, it was dismissed as a conspiracy theory breathlessly by everyone in media, and now, you know, whatever you think about it, even our intelligence agencies have said that it's likely the case, many of our intelligence agencies, but everyone in media dismissed that as a conspiracy theory. They said it was xenophobic. Some went so far as to say that it was racist, and this was all a breathless chorus, everyone speaking in one voice, because they didn't know people that disagreed with them, and they couldn't then say, this fact that I'm insisting is a fact, it might not be a fact. Maybe I should ask some questions about it. So we're going to get to questions in just a second, and I'm excited. I love questions, but I need two volunteers to read their 2 to 3 sentences about the chandelier. I see a hand up here and back there. We'll start over here. Give me your 2 to 3 sentences on that chandelier.
This is 4 sentences, so perfect. I apologize. The chandelier on the ceiling of this large room is one of 4 massive light sources in the center of the main hall. The closest chandelier to the speaker, this one specifically, it is black, ring-shaped, and has 8 lights on the outside of the circle, and on the inside are 8 chains that connect the chandelier to the ceiling, making a teepee shape. Each light bulb is on top of a small black cylinder, which is connected to a much wider cylinder that is connected to the main black ring through a small tube on either cylinder. The large black cylinder is detailed with a black rose directly opposite to the tube that connects it to the ring. Then a glass cylinder shoots up, surrounding the light, but not closing it off.
Whoa, all right. I think that was 40 sentences. Scientific. All right, go ahead.
Not bad at all. A round, circular, maybe wooden or metal frame with cup holders for fake candles, all held up by chains from the ceiling.
Excellent. Okay, think about this. Let's get a round of applause, round of applause. This is the most interesting time I've ever, these are the most interesting answers for all the times I've ever done this experiment. Because, listen, first we talked about how this was the closest chandelier to the speaker. So that's selection bias, right? You're talking about this relative to another item in the room. So choosing to describe the chandelier as being closest to the speaker, choosing to give its color, choosing to say that it's black, choosing to say that it had 8 lights, and choosing to say that it was held up by chains. So then in the other description, it was described as round. It was described as maybe wooden. These are two people describing the exact same objects, but they chose different parts of it to describe. And that's going to change. Imagine you've never seen this chandelier before, and you're reading this, you know, back home in Indiana, and you're trying to figure out what was being described. You're going to think of something different, right, based on both descriptions. Isn't that interesting? That's what happens with the news media every single day. That's happening with war. That's happening with the food that you eat. It's happening with your faith. It's happening with absolutely everything. And the one group of people that we pay to do it right, journalists, they're only getting worse. So think about whatever takes over for TikTok 83 years from now. And remember that as a voter, some things are news, some things are not news, some things are true, and some things are not true. Keep that in mind, and I'll be happy to take some questions now if we have time.
We do have time for some Q&A, so if you can line up with Connor over there and then come up here with a question, remember to state your name, your school, and one brief question.
Good morning. My name is Peter Daly. I'm homeschooled through Mother of Divine Grace. This is kind of a generic question.
Sure. But
what are some things, maybe things we can start now or later, that you suggest aspiring journalists do? Or maybe how should we just get started in it?
Yeah, this is a great question. If you're interested in career in journalism, this sounds really basic, but read as much news as you possibly can, because one of the biggest currencies in journalism is knowing what's being reported and knowing like some basic political history, knowing you know what happened during the Trump administration, the Biden administration, maybe even read about the Obama administration. Read books about journalism so that you can sort of speak about the industry fluently and understand it, you know, just like any industry, whether you're, you know, working as a contractor or you're working human resources, journalism sort of speaks its own language. And if you can come in knowing that language, you have a lot of context to kind of understand what's happening. And that gives you a huge leg up over other people who, you know, there's nothing wrong with this. I studied political science in college and decided to get into journalism, you know, later in college. But it gives you a leg up if you are just one of those people who consumes the news, inhales the news, as much of it as you possibly can. That gives you a huge advantage over other people. So be a good writer too. Read a lot in general and really focus. Whether it's writing emails, whether it's, you know, even silly things, whether it's your class papers, focus on being a good writer because if you're not a good writer, I don't know, you're not even gonna be able to write your scripts for the TikTok videos that you're making. So just focus on writing too. Great question. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Freckin Stuhlsatz. I'm part of the Blue Ridge Academy. And what is the most interesting interview that you've ever had? And what did you take away from it?
Ooh, that's a good question. Most interesting interview that I've ever had. Oh, there's so, man. All right. I'm trying to think on the spot here. I've interviewed a lot of members of Congress, a lot of senators. I've done some interviews with you know, people who have just interesting life stories, like a lot of really people with really interesting pro-life stories. I interviewed a lot of people on January 6th. That was really interesting, talking to people who were there. I was outside the Capitol covering what was happening. And actually, on my way, I was covering the whole day. It started with a speech done by the White House, and I walked with everybody as they were walking to the Capitol, and most of them had no idea what was about to happen. And as I was just talking to people in the crowd, one woman, I just absolutely at random started talking to her. Turned out she was from like my hometown, small town of 7,000 people in the middle of Wisconsin, and worked at a store, the small store that I grew up going to all of the time. And she seemed like the most normal person in the world. And that really changed my perspective. If I hadn't been there, I think, and if I hadn't talked to her and some of her friends and why she was out there, I think that would have really, I think it would have a really different impression of what happened that day. I've interviewed a really good interview with Rand Paul recently, talking about privacy concerns. Marco Rubio, Ted Cruz, those guys are all really interesting. I've interviewed some Democrats. I interviewed Alan Dershowitz once about the Jeffrey Epstein case. That was a really interesting interview, if you guys Google that. But you know, interviews are always really fun because it's an opportunity to pick someone's brain. And as a journalist, by the way, this is a good reason to go into journalism. It's really fun to have the power over someone who sees themselves as very powerful. They're terrified of journalists. Even if journalists are like 23 years old, they're terrified of you because you have the power to write something that could ruin their career, basically. So if you're interested in holding politicians accountable or holding business leaders accountable, journalism is a great career for you because it's a lot of fun to actually hold them accountable and to be the one in that position where you're asking some of the tough questions. So that's a long answer, but those are the random ones that came to mind.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hello, I'm Kennedy Stevens, homeschooled from Indiana.
I know where you're from. I've heard about you, Kennedy.
Should
her, I her teacher, her teacher is a family friend.
Yes. Yeah. I think I know who you're talking about.
Yes.
But yes. So I, first of all, you're my the speaker I was most looking forward to, and you did not disappoint. So thank you.
Wow. Okay. Thank you.
And I think my question would be, for all the big news sources, you're supposed to take like 4 or 5 grains of salt with everything you read. So besides the Federalist, what news sources could you recommend to me?
Great question. I recommend you read everything. Like, read stuff on the left, read stuff on the right. One of the publications on the left that I read the most is Jacobin. It's an openly socialist publication. So you're going to get basically the best version of the left's argument. In any given moment. You know, read the New York Times, the Washington Post, just to get the best version of that argument. From the conservative side, I read the Federalist, I read the Daily Caller, the Washington Examiner, National Review. I mean, I kind of read everything, so I'm the worst person to ask this question to, because journalists, all we do all day is refresh our Twitter feeds. It's the like most unhealthy thing that you can possibly do for a job. But it's great. You should all do it. And it just means that, you know, you read everything. So good sources that curate news, like the Drudge Report, it'll take you everywhere. Twitter, it'll take you to all of these different publications. You know, and now it's the same thing with podcasts. So I listen to podcasts that bring in different voices that don't just misrepresent one side. Like, I don't want a partisan version of what the left is doing. I want like the best representation of it, so that when I'm arguing against it, I'm actually arguing against what they're saying. Does that make sense? Not arguing against like a partisan talking a point about what the left thinks, but actually what they think. So I just recommend like for everyone, rigorously read, listen to liberal sources. I like Glenn Greenwald. I like Matt Taibbi. I'm on Substack. I really like the Free Press. That's Barry Weiss's publication. I recommend that. So just like consume everything, and especially make an emphasis on consuming perspectives from the left, so that when you are arguing and thinking through these issues, you're going to have a better argument than anyone else because you're arguing against their actual beliefs, not a misrepresentation of their beliefs. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Cool.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kennedy. I like how we're doing this like it's American Idol. Like everyone's in a line, and then Connor just ushers someone forward, and they stand on an X. All right, sorry.
Yeah, we'll have time for one final question.
I'm amused by it.
In your speech, I heard you refer to yourself as an opinionated journalist, but within the free press, should objectivity or advocacy be prioritized?
Yeah, it's a great question. So there's a difference between, I would say, advocacy and opinion. So rarely do I advocate or endorse. I never endorse like a candidate or anything like that, which I would consider that more advocacy. I'm an advocate for sort of the broader conservative worldview, but I'm not advocating for anything that's happening in one party or the other. I despise both parties equally, basically. specifically because I'm constantly being lied to by members of both parties. That's a fun thing when you're a journalist too. People just lie to you like it's, you know, there's no tomorrow. They just love lying. So I think there's opinion and advocacy, and they're sometimes the same, but they're not always the same. I think it's healthier because everybody has an opinion, whether it's, you know, that it's important to describe that as wooden or black. That's an opinion, right? That's an opinion that was made up in someone's mind. So everyone has an opinion. Most of us cannot stuff those opinions into a jar and pretend they don't exist. Some people can. I know a few people who can do that. They're very good neutral journalists, but most of us can't do that. And so I think it's important for most journalists to be honest and to come out and be openly opinion journalists, you know, whether they're the Whigs or the Democratic Republican Party, if we go all the way back to, you know, the early days of the Republic when there were partisan pamphlets. I actually think it's a better model. The opinion journalism is a better model. I don't love advocacy journalism because I think that necessarily makes you lie on behalf of causes or cover up on behalf of any given cause, but I think opinion journalism is a better model. With, you know, those people who can be neutral, great. God love them. They should still be neutral. But that's a great question, and it's kind of a complicated one. I just think most of us have an opinion, so most of us should be honest about having an opinion.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course. Thank you guys so much. Thank you guys. That's so nice. And in all seriousness, you can email me, ejashinsky@yaf.org. All right, thanks, guys.